Well, grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm glad that you are here today, that you stuck it out, and despite the rain and the temptation to go home after eating such good food, that you are here to worship with us. And besides, the more bodies that are in here, the warmer you'll be. So, again, it's good to have you here. In lieu of the prelude today, we're just going to spend a short time in meditation. And so I'd like us to prepare our hearts and minds for worship by spending some time in prayer. And so if it feels like it's a long time, trust me, it's not nearly as long as you think it is, most likely. Having taken 2 minutes to quiet your minds, center your hearts and souls, would you stand to worship God as we say our response to call the Lord? It is a great day to be here.
There are so many things we can do to serve the Lord.
Just listen for God's call to you. Let God guide your life.
We are willing to open our lives to God's service.
Come, let's worship and celebrate God's good news for us.
Let us bring our hopes and prayers to God with joy.
Amen. There is in your bulletin insert a copy of How Great Thou Art, or since we're actually here in the church, if you want bigger print, it's in your hymnal number 32.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul.
Our sins with repentant hearts, knowing that they shall be forgiven. Together, let us say the unison prayer of confession printed in your bulletin, and then let us go singly and silently before the throne. Let us pray. Patient Lord, we know that you call us to service, but we often feel inadequate. We love to make excuses for not doing something, or for doing something only half-heartedly. Remind us again of your loving and guiding presence. Forgive us when we stumble and falter. Turn us again to you, serving joyfully and confidently. In Jesus' name we pray. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. We are new creatures in Christ. the old life has gone, a new life has begun. Know that in Jesus Christ you are forgiven, and be at peace. Amen.
Glory to the Father, and to
we are going to be doing special music here. Zach is listed in the offertory, but we're going to do it here. This is a spiritual called Wade into Water. And as Zach noted to me, spirituals by nature are call and response. And there is a response in the verses. Every time we go through a verse, he'll sing a line, and then there is a response, God's gonna trouble the water. That's all there is to it. God's gonna trouble the water. So if you would like to be bold and sing with moi when I'm doing the responses, please feel free to do so.
Wade in the water, wade in the water, children, wade in the water, God's gonna trouble the water, wade in the water, wade in the water, children. Trouble the water. See that host all dressed in white. God's gonna trouble the water. Looks like the children of the Israelites. God's gonna trouble the water. Wade in the water. Wade in the water. Children, wade in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. See that band all dressed in red. God's gonna trouble the water. Looks like the band that Moses led. God's gonna trouble the water. Wade in the water, wade in the water, children, wade in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. Who's that child all dressed in blue? God's gonna trouble the water. Must be the children that's a-coming through. God's gonna trouble the water. Wade in the water. Wade in the water, children. Wade in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. I stepped in water and the water is cold. God's gonna trouble the water. Said it chilled my body but not my soul. God's gonna trouble the water. Wade in the water. Wade in the water, children. Wade in the water. God's gonna trouble the water. Well, I went to the water one day to pray. God's gonna trouble the
Father,
and my soul got happy and I stayed all day.
God's gonna trouble the water.
Wait in the water.
Wait in the water, children.
Wait in the water.
God's gonna trouble the water.
If you don't believe I've been redeemed,
God's gonna trouble the water.
Just follow me down to Jordan Stream.
God's gonna trouble the water.
Wait in the water.
Wait in the water, children.
Wait in the water.
God's gonna trouble the water.
If you get there before I do,
God's gonna trouble the water.
Tell all of my friends I'm coming too.
God's gonna trouble the water.
Wait in the water.
Wait in the water, children.
Wait in the water.
God's gonna trouble the water.
Looked over yonder, what did I see?
God's gonna trouble the water.
The Holy Ghost are coming for me.
God's gonna trouble the water.
Wait in the water.
Wait in the water, children.
Wait in the water.
God's gonna trouble the water.
God's gonna trouble the water.
Teenagers, and I thought, you know, that's not everybody can remember their baptism. I know my mom can because she was older, she can remember hers, and like I said, not too many of us can because I was just a baby. But I found two meanings, but I gave them to mom, and I didn't tell her which one I liked, but we liked the same. So here's the meaning for Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. When Jesus was baptized, he went under, not like a sprinkle of water. When Jesus came up, he felt like a new person, like when we take a bath. It makes us feel better after we take one. Being baptized is important because Jesus made sure that it was the first thing he started in his ministry and the last thing he said going up to heaven. He felt he had to be baptized so he could teach his disciples what to do, telling them to do just as he did. Mark 1, verses 9 through 11. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, was baptized by John in the Jordan, and just as he was coming out of the water, he saw the heavens torn, and voice came from the heavens saying, "You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased." Now we have Ezekiel 36, verses 23 through 29. And the sprinkling of the water is a symbol of cleaning the sin. And the Old Testament tells us that sprinkling and washing with water is pictured with cleansing from with water and is pictured cleansing from abusement. God will purify Israel from a God will, and God will impart a new life. Ezekiel 36, 23 through 29. "I will sanctify my great name, which has been profound among the nations, and which you have profound among them. And the nations shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God. When through you I display my holiness, before their eyes I will take you from the nations and gather you from the countries, and bring you into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water upon you. You shall be clean from all your uncleanliness and from all your idols. I will cleanse you. A new heart I will give you, and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove from your body the heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and make you follow my statutes and be careful to observe any ordinances. Then we shall live in the land that I gave to your ancestors, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. I will save you from all your uncleanness, and I will summon the grain and make it abundant and lay no famine upon you." The word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Tim. We continue our study in Mark. This is the third week. In an attempt to get a more in-depth understanding of the whole life of Jesus and all of its scope. And again, as a reminder, this is supplemented at the Tuesday morning Bible study. We get into far more depth on things than I can here. If you have questions, that's the time to bring them. I guess you could email me and I could answer them there as well. We are in the peak time of John the Baptizer's ministry. We went through that last week about how he was a herald for Christ. He's having the largest impact of his time in his biggest crowds. It said thousands would come out to see him. And again, remember, this was not like going across the street. Okay? This would be more along the lines, I think, of a University of Iowa home game, only you had to walk. And they would walk as far as 10, 15 miles, and you would have everybody crammed in. You know, when you try and get through the gates and into the stadium, it's always really cramped. We went to Silver Dollar City on our vacation down in Branson. And even with a VIP pass that got us in, we still had to wait to get through the turnstile things. And the boys went on at least one, maybe two rides. And again, you just had to stand out there and wait. And wait. And wait. They even had a little sign there, you know, approximate wait time on one of them, the most popular roller coaster they had. And at one point I saw it was a 45-minute wait, and I was like, who's going to stand in line 45 minutes for a 2.5-minute ride?
Yeah.
A lot of people. These crowds were coming out, and Jesus comes from Nazareth. It's about 10 miles. He has not begun his ministry, and is just now moving out to do so. There are solid cultural reasons for his not going until now that you can find out if you come to the Bible study on Tuesday morning. Because that is more background to the event occurring here that I want to explore today. Now, one of the initial questions that's been asked through the ages that might have run through your mind that Pam alluded to is, why would Jesus need a baptism of repentance? I mean, that's what John was preaching. And in fact, in Matthew's gospel, John the Baptizer basically says exactly the same thing, recognizing Jesus' purity and righteousness. John says, I should be baptized by you, not by me. You, not by me. And Jesus says, in response, to do it for, quote, in this way it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness, unquote. So Jesus had a purpose in doing it. And we'll get more on that question soon. Now I want to take a brief overview of this short three-verse passage with the baptism. As we had the baptism, something happened. It says the heavens were torn asunder. If you read the Greek, actually they say opened in most of your translations. And this voice came down and said, you are my son, the beloved. Now, I would like to note that each gospel takes a slightly different tack on this baptism statement. They all have the baptism. But Mark, for instance, treats it as a personal vision, and we're going to get more into that. Matthew, I won't call it a crowd hallucination, but that's the closest I can come to it. Everybody heard it. And even the wording is changed. Instead of, you are my beloved son, it says, this is my beloved son in whom I am well. He's obviously making a pronouncement to the people. In another one of the Gospels, it says they heard thunder rolling. That was what they heard when they heard the voice of God. Perhaps they weren't prepared to hear. They did not have ears to hear what he said. And yet they knew that he was there. A real tangible event, possibly. In the Gospel of John, it says, the Holy Spirit came down in the form of a dove. Not like a dove, but in the form of a dove and rested on John's shoulder. So this baptism was obviously something important. This vision was obviously something important. And we're going to explore here what it means to Mark and then what it means to us. Jesus came from Nazareth. As one commentary says, it was an insignificant distance to travel physically, but a monumental step in his answering the Father's call to a vocation. I want you to think for a moment about his going into the ministry, about his call to a vocation. He was 30 years old. He was a carpenter. He was a carpenter's son. He'd been raised up to run the family business. So he's leaving behind all that was familiar, all that was close, his home, his family support network, and his source of income, and his status. We see signs of what it cost him elsewhere. When Jesus notes things like, quote, a prophet is never honored in his hometown, unquote, that's just before they decide to try and throw him off a cliff, by the way. And another time he says, the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. He left everything. We will see later in Mark that Jesus' family does not support him in his ministry as an itinerant preacher. That's right. They even call him crazy and tell him to come back home. We know that neither of the two brothers that are listed in the scripture, Jude and James, who are both described as brothers of Jesus, they each have their own little book, believed until after the resurrection that Jesus was the Messiah. This is his brothers. They grew up with him. And I'm not going to get into what it would be like to grow up with Jesus. Somebody who's sinless, even through his childhood, somebody who managed to be perfect in all things. I bet you that caused a lot of anxiety and strife amongst the rest of the family members there. But as I said, we're not going to go into that. They didn't support him, though, when he went into ministry. At least not initially. Sometimes our answering God's call to do something in particular for God will cost us. It would be well to remember how Jesus set the example before we ask or cry, "How could you be so hard, God?" Another commentator, William Barclay, is one that I happen to like, notes that for Jesus, the baptism was a moment of decision, identification, approval, and equipping. And I'm going to use those four words and give my own spin on things. It was the moment that Christ chose to answer the Father's call to public ministry. So that was his decision. And you all, many of you all, have heard my story of my call to ministry. And it took a conscious decision. That's all I'm going to say for today. It took a conscious decision. And for me, because I'm either stupid or stubborn or however you want to go about it, it took a long time for me to say yes. Christ knew that this was the time the Father had intended. And he said, "I will follow your will, Father." And he went forward into public ministry. And in that moment of baptism, Christ chose to identify with the movement of God in the call to repentance. That's what John the Baptizer was preaching, right? The call to repentance. If you look at what Jesus preached, the first thing he said was, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." He was going right along with it. Even though Jesus didn't need it, he wasn't going to call people to go through anything that he was not willing to undergo. Think about that for a moment. He was not willing to tell and ask anybody to do anything that he was not willing to do himself. I mean, how would it have been if he had called people to repent of their sins and get baptized, and when they asked him if he'd have done it, he just said, "Nah, I don't need to. I'm the sinless Son of God." Well, that would have been true. I imagine very few people would have placed their faith in him as Savior. They would have seen him as obnoxious or arrogant, or at best might have wondered how Jesus could possibly understand them and where they were if he wasn't even willing to undergo what he was asking anyone who followed him to do. It was a point where Jesus got the personal seal of approval from the Father. Mark makes it clear in his account that Jesus' baptism that only Jesus sees the heavens part and hears the voice say, "You are my Son, the Beloved, in you I am well pleased." Later on in the Transfiguration, when the disciples are there, God's going to say something a little different. And we'll get to that when we get there. It was a moment of equipping for Jesus as well in the Spirit. As all the Synoptic Gospels note that Jesus was impelled or sent into the wilderness by the Holy Spirit, where Jesus was prepared then for the battles to come. 40 days, and we're going to get into that when we get into the temptation much more fully, but 40 days he was driven into this by the Spirit into the wilderness. The same wilderness that John had come from. Or maybe worse, because Jesus couldn't find any food. I guess he wasn't good at catching locusts. He fasted for 40 days. He was being prepared for the battles to come that were going to take great spiritual strength and discipline. As we consider what this passage has to tell us in a practical manner, we need, I believe, to focus on the identification process our own call by God to a vocation and or ministry, and what our equipping means. There isn't time, again, to go into this in great depth, but we should be able to draw some parallels to our passage today. The first is our identification. It was in the baptism Jesus identified with us. Likewise, in our baptism, we are identified with Christ. You go to Romans chapter 6, in particular verses 3 to 7, Colossians 2:12, Galatians 2:19-21. All of them speak of how we are die with Christ as we are baptized, we are raised with Christ as we come out of the water, or we're finished with the baptism. It is in that moment of baptism that we are identified with Christ. In the Presbyterian Church, because we have infant baptism, not just adult believer baptism, we believe in that moment that we are identified with Christ in that we become part of the people of God. God places his mark upon us as a sign and seal of his grace through the faith of the parents. And then that faith is confirmed and affirmed when the children as young adults go through confirmation class and then stand before you to make their profession of faith. We're named co-heirs with Christ, sons of the Father with all the power and authority of Christ, as we live in and act in Christ. This is rooted in our confession of faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and the sign and seal of that is baptism. Secondly, we're called to a vocation and ministry for God. Now, your vocation is probably not to preach the gospel every Sunday from the pulpit, though if anyone would like to preach at any time, just let me know. But you do have your own call and challenges. I have always said that being a farmer is a vocation. And so is being a teacher and a doctor and so many others. It's more than just a job. It is a part of who you are. John Maxwell once told a story where he said that he was given a conference, and as he gave the conference, he talked about everyone having a vocation and being ordained into that vocation. And during one of the breaks, somebody came up and greeted him, and he said, "Guess what?" And John said, "What?" He said, "I'm an ordained plumber." Likewise, you also have a ministry waiting for you. Something specific where God uses you to bring the knowledge of his saving love and grace to others. It might be in the church. It might even be outside the church. But you need to look for the opportunity God is presenting. Please note that following a vocation is not easy. Because it is integral to you, it is precious to you. Every day you will be challenged. Every day you will be tempted. Every day you must rededicate yourself to your call. And sometimes, let's face it, there will be a great battle. It will be a fight just to get yourself out of bed and to your work. And I'm not just speaking of physical illness or even depression, etc. It could be a battle over distractions, direction, or duration. Is this the way it's supposed to go? Am I still where I'm supposed to be? Or are you calling me somewhere else? And we'll have more of that as well in the Bible study. Thirdly, we are equipped by the Holy Spirit. We, like Christ, have the Holy Spirit living within us. That's the promise of Christ. We've been given gifts and talents and tools to accomplish his will, spiritual gifts. And if you want to check your Bible out or you do a Google search of spiritual gifts, you're going to find a whole lot of different lists. There's at least two that I know of in the scriptures of gifts, and that's not even talents. There's also calls that are mentioned in there. You can find a variety of different things. If you take one of these spiritual gift inventories, and I've got several of them, I'm more than happy to let you guys take one. Depending on its focus, you can have... They usually want you to find out the top six out of the 20 or 30 that are listed there. That might give you some idea of how God can gift you. And that gift is there to equip you for your ministry with others. As we follow the great commission of Christ to make disciples of all nations and to teach them what Christ has commanded us. So Christ's baptism was not just a fly in the night thing. It had a purpose for him. It had a purpose for us. Christ's baptism is not something that we can say, well, that's cool, it's done. But something that we need to consider regularly in our own lives. Because I don't believe we can consider our own baptisms without considering his. And I think sometimes we need to consider our own baptism more often than we do. What does it mean that I have been baptized into Christ? That's the question to ask yourself. By the way, as an aside, since we're Presbyterians and we have this thing called a Book of Confessions, they have wonderful explanations of that in a variety of our confessions, in a number of them. I would encourage you, we have books of confessions here in the office. I would encourage you to look it up sometime. And even if you don't do that, if you've got a study Bible, I'm sure that any study Bible, when it talks about baptism, in any of those passages I gave you, or even Jesus' baptism, is going to tell you something about what the editors of that think it means. Think about what it means to you. Because it is in that recognition of our baptism that we gain our understanding of who we are in Jesus Christ. It is in that understanding of our baptism that we gain our understanding of our authority of who we are in Jesus Christ. And it is in that reflection on our baptism that we gain our understanding of whose we are and what we can do with God as our Father. May that reflection be a source of challenge, but also a source of joy for each and every one of you always. That you would give God praise and glory for his wondrous love shown in our adoption through Jesus Christ. Amen. The insert on the other side has the unison song, Be Thou My Vision. Huh? Sure, we could do the Apostles' Creed first. If you'd stand as you're able. Join me in affirming, now that I talk about the confessions, what the Church has confessed through the ages.
I believe in God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please remain standing.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence, my light. Riches I need not, nor man's empty praise. Thou my inheritance, never the waste. And thou only first in my heart. I King of heaven, my treasure thou art. I King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven, joyful, bright and sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Please be seated. Through our gifts, our love can extend beyond the boundaries of race and color, class and creed. Through our gifts, we break through the barriers that divide us, and we extend a hand that shares and heals. Let us present our tithes and offerings, and as the ushers come forward, meditate on God's blessings that you give joyfully and generously to the work of this church here in Wapello in the morning sun. Please stand with me as we sing the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
This is our time when we would have our prayers of the people. It is a time when we get to share our concerns and our joys. I would ask you to consider those that are in your insert, the other part of your insert, which I seem to have misplaced in my thing. Pray for these people by name. There are things that are new, there are things that are old, but all of them have need. Are there other concerns that are not listed in here? Pam?
I'd like for everybody to pray for Mom after her fall. She's okay, but she's hurting really bad.
Joy or concern? Carol.
A joy for the generosity of the families that have the grill for their generosity this morning.
Yes,
just for the halls.
Okay. Lynn.
Craig Swagger was taken from the nursing home last week and was in
So he was taken back to the hospital?
Yes, he was taken back.
Joy or concern? Best part.
Continue prayers to the boys and family, that Aaron's pain, the block they did on him, works, and that his lungs don't keep filling up fluid. They put a tube in him, so hopefully he'll do better. He is home.
Martha.
Joy, yesterday there was a handful of us that worked in the clothes closet, putting out the winter clothes, and even on a closed work day, we were able to help a family out. A lady came in, I think, that had five or six children, and she filled up her back of her truck full of clothes that they needed.
Okay. Yes, Pam?
We had several joys. I was asking people about your prayer list, but I can give you an update on several people. First of all, Dorothy Malcolm is well. She has been declared as free of cancer as anybody can be. Kaylee Schneider, the little girl, is back in school. Her treatment has been fairly successful. She was a little girl with childhood leukemia. Marianne Booth is doing fine. She is in the care center of Morning Sun, but she's doing well. So, and I asked Kathy Dale.
Who's going to be mine?
Yeah. Okay, I'll give it over to you, Kathy.
Okay, I am Joy. I went to Mayo Clinic and my elbow is feeling like it's supposed to.
Good.
John, also, Dean Bronze has been moved from Wapello to Muscatine.
Lutheran homes.
Yeah.
To Lutheran home?
Yes.
Any other joys or concerns? Let's come before God in prayer then, knowing that He knows our needs even better than we do. Lord God in heaven, Abba Father, we give You thanks and praise. You are an awesome God. Lord, You're almighty, You're all-knowing. You know our needs better than we do ourselves. You're able to do anything that is within Your will and Your nature. And You're a good God who loves us. And so You intend good for us in Your plan. Sometimes we don't see it at the moment. Sometimes it's hard for us, Lord. We see all of the strife in the world. And even though we recognize that it really comes from us and our willful natures, our fallen natures, nevertheless, we cry out, why don't You fix it? But You already have. You already have in Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask that You would continue to bless us. We give You thanks for the good news of Kathy's elbow healing like it's supposed to. For Mary Ellen Griffith being okay at the care center. For Dorothy being well and for Haley being back in school. We give You thanks that we were able to help a family in terms of giving them clothing. Lord, we appreciate those opportunities to minister to others. We give You thanks for the generosity of the owners of the Odessa Grill and for their wanting to share in their fellowship with us. Lord, may their blessings be great as they try to show Your love to those who come into their place. And Lord, we ask that You would lay Your healing hands upon all who are sick and are hurt. Whether it be spiritual, physical, or mental, Lord, make them whole to serve Your purposes and to do Your will. We pray for Pam's mom after her fall. Lord, help Rosemary to overcome the pain. Help her to be certain of what she needs to do and to be willing to do it. We pray for Aaron Boyson that the nerve block might work, that his lungs would not fill with fluid so much, that he might be comfortable and strengthen the family as well at this time. They are such strong believers in you, and I know that you are with them, and they know you are with them. But it is a hard time nonetheless. We pray for Craig, had to be taken back into the hospital and have surgery again. Lord, we pray that you would strengthen his body that he might recover. Lord, so much need, but you see it all. So many hurts, but you can heal them all. And for all of those situations, may you give us your peace that passes all understanding, that only comes from you, so that we know that we are in your hands regardless of where we are and what's going on. Jesus, Prince of Peace, come back soon. Bring your peace to the entire world as every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that you are Lord, and the world is made right once more. Holy Spirit, you who were given to us in our baptism, you who reached out and regenerated us and opened our eyes so that we might see the way to have faith in you, we ask that you would pour yourself out upon us now. Give us wisdom to understand who we are and whose we are. Give us courage to sacrifice, to walk in a way that you call us to walk. Give us the perseverance of spirit to complete those tasks that you have for us, that we might be faithful witnesses. And Holy Spirit, be poured out upon this church. Expand its boundaries and ministries. Keep it from evil. Lord, may we in Wapello and Morning Sun both be lights in the darkness of this world, beacons of joy and hope that show your love and grace and mercy to others so that they can experience it and come to know you as they hear the good news of Jesus Christ. For we ask all of this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If you would please stand as you're able, and you can either use the insert, or because that's such tiny print, if you want to go to your hymnal for this one, join me in singing number 385, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Take my life and let it be, consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love, at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Messages for thee.
Now, may you go forth from this place, recharged, renewed, challenged, yet secure in God's love, sharing the good news of the gospel with all whom you meet. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.
All shall be.